All right, good morning, everybody. We are, oops, sorry about that. Classic. Don't give me that, give me that. Yes, keep. Here we go. Okay, reboot. All right. So, good morning, everybody. This is the OpenStack Tour de Force tutorial. This is a tutorial that is built for 1 hour, which is extremely short for the content that we're about to present. However, as we're going into the lunch break afterward, I'll be happy to stick around for questions later, just in case we do happen to run out of time and cannot cover all of the questions that you may have. This is, if you want to follow along the tutorial itself on your own VirtualBox images, you are welcome to do so. However, it is not required. This tutorial is being recorded. It's going to be available for your perusal afterward. And of course, the virtual machines themselves are also going to be available on Ubuntu One or Dropbox for you to download from. And by the way, all of the slides here are free for you to use for any purpose you wish under the CC BY-SA license, and I'm going to make my slides available as a GitHub link at the end of the talk. So for those of you who do want to follow along, this is how you do it. You grab the files, you start VirtualBox, you create one instance of the puppet.ova virtual appliance, and you create three instances of the OpenStack OVA virtual appliance. You name them Alice, Bob, and Charlie, and make sure you reinitialize their MAC addresses when you create them. You can log in to all of these boxes as root with the password of OpenStack. And for the OpenStack nodes, you have to run a little script. It's called fixuphost. It runs in the slash, or it's stored in the slash root directory. And if you run that as root, fixuphost Alice, fixuphost Bob, fixuphost Charlie, then it will make that OpenStack virtual appliance three different nodes with three different network configurations named Alice, Bob, and Charlie, and you can then use them for this tutorial. Once you reboot, you're ready to go. There's nothing that you need to do on the Puppet node itself. It will just come up pre-configured as a Puppet master. Okay, so much for that. We're going to start with the OpenStack Tour de Force, subtitled Cloud from Scratch in No Time. This is the third time that we're presenting this tutorial. The first time was at OSCON in Portland this year. Then my colleague Adolfo Brangis did a version of this talk at Cloud Open North America in New Orleans, and now we're here in Scotland and we're doing it again, but this time we are doing it for the OpenStack Havana release, which just dropped last week. So, here we go. You may be wondering just who the heck I am. My name is Florian. There are a few links on this slide here. There is my sort of corporate bio. I am one of the co-founders and an instructor and principal consultant at hastexo. The top link here is my official corporate page. The second one, the short link here, is my Google Plus. You can get in touch with me by email at florian@hastexo.com. I'm one of those strange holdouts that don't maintain a personal Twitter account, but we do have a company Twitter present. That's hastexo. And if you want to know more about our training work that we do around OpenStack, I encourage you to visit academy.hastexo.com. That has all of the information about our training services. Now, for those of you, can I have a show of hands, please? Who in here is familiar with OpenStack in the sense that they have looked at OpenStack or deployed an OpenStack instance in production or in testing up to this point? Quite a few. Okay, great. The rest are complete OpenStack novices. Can I just have a nod your head? Okay, all right. Quick, very brief overview of the OpenStack architecture. OpenStack is comprised of a set of services, all of them under the ASL2.0 license, all written in Python, and all working together using RESTful JSON APIs. At the core of everything, we have an identity service called Keystone,
which provides authentication, authorization, and access control, and also maintains the concept of tenants, which means we can logically subdivide a physical OpenStack cloud into multiple logical tenants. And then every object that we create within that cloud belongs to a certain tenant. All our access control patterns and all that can be set up on a per, or are set up on a per tenant basis. We then have an image store, codenamed Glance in OpenStack. The image store basically maintains our gold images, gold master images for our virtual workloads, our virtual guests. Those run in OpenStack Compute, also known as Nova. OpenStack Compute can support a number of backend hypervisors. The canonical way of doing it might arguably be libvirt with KVM, which is what we're doing here in this tutorial today, but it equally supports the Xen hypervisors, VMware in two different flavors, actually, one through vCenter and one interacting with ESXi directly. It supports Hyper-V, and it has recently gained much improved support for container-based virtualization rather than hardware emulation-based virtualization as well. We have a network service, which in the Grizzly release still used to be called Quantum. It has since been renamed and is now called Neutron. So Neutron, the OpenStack networking service, provides network connectivity within our virtual tenants between virtual machines and also to the outside world. We have a block storage service, codenamed Cinder, provides persistent block storage to guests. And we also have an object storage service, codenamed Swift, which provides RESTful object storage within an OpenStack cloud. And then we have a unified OpenStack dashboard, codenamed Horizon, which acts as a unified UI across all these services, which is web-based. Runs is based on Django, and WSGI runs in Apache normally and provides a unified link for all of this. And there are two new facilities in OpenStack Havana, released last week and developed over the past 6 months, which are facilities for metering and alert services, a project codenamed Celometer, and an orchestration engine that provides both its own native API and an AWS CloudFormation compatible API codenamed Heat. So two more OpenStack sub-projects that just had their first OpenStack, official OpenStack release dropped last week, OpenStack Celometer and OpenStack Havana. So from this logical overview of the OpenStack architecture, what follows is the concept of node roles. And node roles are sort of logical, atomic, and composable classes of nodes in an OpenStack cloud. They're atomic because they're usually not broken down further. They're composable because it's very common for a single node to have multiple of these roles. Depending on your scale-out requirements, you may then scale them out across multiple physical boxes. And those node roles are, there is an infrastructure node, which runs a database and a message queuing server. The relational database is normally MySQL, but Postgres is also supported. And a message queue server, an AMQP server. Most people will be using RabbitMQ, but Apache Cupid is also supported, and there is support for ZeroMQ as well, although that support has some known limitations. Then we have the authentication node, which runs the OpenStack Identity Service, codenamed Keystone, which provides authentication and a service catalog. We have an API node, which provides RESTful API endpoints to OpenStack services. A controller node, which provides scheduling and registration services that are internal to OpenStack. So for example, what the controller node would control are things like what specific compute node am I scheduling this specific guest to run on. And other things. Then we have the network node, which provides network connectivity within the cloud and also to public external networks. And we have, of course, the compute node. Usually we have several of these, and it's not unusual to have an OpenStack cloud with hundreds or thousands of compute nodes, which of course runs hosts and runs virtual machines, that is to say, Nova guests. Then we have storage nodes, one or several, which provide persistent block storage to guests. There is a very basic implementation of the Cinder, the OpenStack block storage service, which uses LVM and iSCSI, which is what we're going to be using here in this tutorial for demonstration purposes. However, there is a truckload of external drivers that are supported by Cinder where we can interact with existing either open source or commercially licensed storage systems, such as, for example, Ceph, which is highly popular as a scale-out service for software-defined storage. GlusterFS is also supported for that same purpose, but also things like 3PAR, Lefthand, various other SAN vendors, etc. Then we have a dashboard node, which provides a unified user interface to our cloud admins, obviously. And then we have a metering node. This is new in Havana. This is a node type that collects metering data from a unified event stream, which provides a set of counters and gauges related to metering of our OpenStack cloud. And finally, we have an orchestration node, which runs an orchestration engine for complex guest workloads. So this would be the node that would be running the heat engine in OpenStack. In our setup, as for the tutorial architecture, we have a total of four different nodes. Alice is the one that holds the majority of our control-related services. So Alice is our infrastructure node, which runs our database and our RPC server, our authentication node, our API node, controller node, storage node, dashboard node, and also the metering and orchestration node, although I don't know whether the time that we're going to have in this tutorial is going to permit us to actually go to the metering and orchestration stuff. But if you're taking the virtual machines with you, it will be easy for you to reproduce that on your boxes and then have Cloudometer and Heat at your disposal as well. Then we have Bob. That's our compute node. It will be running our virtual workloads, or the virtual workloads that we're going to create at the end of the tutorial. We have Charlie. That's our network node. That's the node that provides access to the outside world and runs services that ensure that the virtual machines can talk together within the cloud as well. And of course, we have our Puppet master node, because we're going to be deploying this whole OpenStack cloud with Puppet, because if we were not automating this, this would be an endeavor that would take us about 2 days, and we want to do it in 1 hour. So obviously, we are going to be automating that with a system automation framework. In this case, we chose Puppet. You can also deploy OpenStack with Chef. You can deploy OpenStack with a variety of other tools, and you can do crazy things like deploy OpenStack within OpenStack using OpenStack tools, if that does not provide a knot in your cerebral cortex. We are going to be using a collection of Puppet modules that are available for configuring OpenStack services. Those are hosted on StackForge. StackForge is a community project that develops third-party additions to OpenStack. Third-party in the sense that what is being developed on StackForge is not or not yet part of OpenStack proper. But the nice thing is it uses the entire continuous integration and continuous deployment and testing infrastructure that the rest of OpenStack also uses, which is great. Which means that most of the stuff that is on StackForge actually has much the same quality level of what OpenStack itself has. And at least in terms of revision control, peer review, etc., that's pretty stellar. We are going to use a simple set of wrappers on top of these Puppet modules on StackForge. We call this Kickstack because it's something that you can use to kickstart your OpenStack. It's really a very, very thin wrapper around what is upstream in StackForge as part of the Puppet OpenStack modules there. Okay. We are going to use the Puppet dashboard Let's see, where's my Puppet dashboard here? There we go. That is a pristine Puppet dashboard. It runs on the node named Puppet. You can access it depending on how you've set up your virtual networks. You can either access it through its actual IP address, which is 192.168.122.100, or you can just connect to localhost port 3000 because it should do a port forwarding there for you. There is no need to use Puppet Dashboard. Kickstack uses, you can use Kickstack with any Puppet ENC and Puppet External Node Classifier. For those of you who are familiar with Puppet, that is a way to, that's a facility that Puppet can use to externally classify nodes, put them into specific classes, etc., apply parameters and variables to them. And the Puppet dashboard is but one implementation of such an ENC. There's others, such as the Foreman, which is very popular with many Puppet heads, including the Puppet heads at CERN that run the largest OpenStack cloud in Europe at this time. And you could actually be writing your own ENC because all that Puppet uses is a bit of YAML that ENC outputs. So that is our Puppet dashboard here. And what we also have, or are going to have, is the OpenStack dashboard, because if I click on this now, obviously it's not here yet, because that is something that we are going to deploy as part of this setup. There we go. And we have our four different physical nodes. So that's our node named Puppet. I actually don't need to do anything here right now. So I'm going to move straight to our node named Alice. And the first thing that we're going to do here is we are going to have it check in with Puppet, which means we're running a quick Puppet agent test. And we are now going to have that check in with Puppet for the first time. Yes, you can crucify me now for purposes of this tutorial alone. I have actually set up Puppet for auto-sign of these SSL certificates. Do not ever do this in production. And by the way, do not deploy these virtual machines in production because they have my SSH public key in /root.ssh/authorized keys. So if you actually deploy this in production and you make it accessible on the internet, prepare for a visit. Okay, we're going to do that on the other nodes as well. So we have them all check into Puppet for the first time. There we go. And while that is chugging along, we can go back to our node named Alice, and indeed we can go back to our Puppet dashboard. So there's two nodes that have checked in, lovely, and then we're gonna have a third one shortly. There we go, Alice, Bob, Charlie. Very creatively, I use the domain name example.com, this is what we are going to be using for the rest of this tutorial. So the first thing that we're gonna do is we are just going to add these three nodes to the Kickstack group such that we can apply these parameters that we can set in the Puppet dashboard globally for all of these nodes. So what I'm doing is I'm selecting the group named Kickstack, go to edit, and down here we can now go ahead and add these nodes. Alice, Bob, Charlie. And there we go. Okay, so we've got that. We've got all of these nodes here in the same group. So the first thing that we're going to do is we are going to work with our node named Alice. And Alice, we are going to make the infrastructure node, the authentication node, and the API node. API, infrastructure, and auth. Oops. And what is this guy doing here? And then we're just going to run our next Puppet run. Again, for purposes of demonstration, obviously I don't have Puppet run as a background service, but I'm just invoking it manually. If you were using this in production, then obviously you would be running it as a background service with a refresh interval. So while that thing is chugging along, let me tell you what an OpenStack API node actually does. So in OpenStack, all of our nodes, all of our services, run on or expose endpoints that are RESTful. We can interact with them with a standard HTTP or HTTPS client. And what we're doing is we're pretty much bouncing around JSON objects is what we're doing. And that is true for all of the OpenStack services. That is true for Cinder as much as it is for Nova, as much as it is for Neutron, Celometer, and all others. And what these services do is they use two means of communications with other services. So if there is anything that actually requires to be persistent, so if at any time a service needs to tell another service, okay, here's a piece of data that you are going to use henceforth and forevermore, then all of that goes into a relational database. As I said earlier, typically we use MySQL here. Postgres is also supported, SQLite as well, but obviously SQLite you wouldn't use in a multi-node environment. And the other means of communication that these nodes use is AMQP. And AMQP is the common message bus that we're using for communications between our nodes. Now, the next thing I'm going to say, it's not, you should take it with a pinch of salt. It's not completely set in stone, but the rough rule is if there's anything that needs to be known for two other nodes for more than 30 seconds, it typically goes into the relational database. And if it's less, then that is information that just lives on the message bus. And those are the two things that we are creating here in this step. We are installing MySQL, or what this thing is doing for us is installing MySQL and installing RabbitMQ as well. And then there's a RabbitMQ service. And then subsequently, it's also going to create the databases, which is what we see here. There we go. So we've got all the databases that we need. And I just want to move over this quickly here, run this puppet agent test again so we get the next run with the actual API services. I want to complete this rather quickly so I can actually show you how we can interact with the OpenStack cloud. It is important to understand, and we're going to see this in a moment, that as soon as we have our OpenStack API services or API endpoints available, then we can actually interact with our OpenStack cloud, even though we don't, for some of these services, for some of these APIs, we actually don't have implementing services as yet. Now, that may sound strange, but it's actually really sound and reasonable design. Which is you want for the API services to be decoupled from the actual implementing controlling services. So at any time you happen to lose connection with a backend service or the backend service actually moves from one node to another, then the system should just find out about that essentially by itself and using the information that the system itself provides. Yes, questions are always good.
Go ahead. How did you deploy on Alice the services?
It's okay if you stay seated. What you do is you put your node named Alice into three Kickstack classes, Kickstack node auth, Kickstack node API, and Kickstack node infrastructure. Those are the three classes, and they also need to be part of the Kickstack group.
What was the root password again, sorry?
What is that?
What was the root password?
OpenStack, all lowercase. So while we're waiting for this to chug along, this is also configuring Keystone for us. As I said, Keystone is the OpenStack identity service. That's the service that is responsible for providing OpenStack authentication, authorization, and access control. And Keystone also manages the OpenStack endpoints. So if we, and what this job here does for us is creates this little OpenStack RC file, which we can now source, and that provides our OpenStack credentials for us. So if we do that, we can actually go ahead and do a Keystone endpoint list. And as of right now, we only have one endpoint in there. And this was already interaction with an OpenStack cloud using OpenStack tools. So I used Keystone endpoint lists to basically tell, ask OpenStack, OK, where are my API endpoints? And right now, I only have one, which is Keystone itself, arguably, because that's the only service that I have currently actually configured. And with the next run, we are actually going to configure the API services themselves. And okay, and while this is running, let me go back to my overview. Come on. Here we go. There's that. So what we're currently doing is we are configuring, or we have already configured, the identity service. And the next thing that we're doing is we're configuring API endpoints for all of the other services, actually more than are shown in the slide here. We're not doing it just for network and block storage and compute and image. But we're also doing it for metering and orchestration, so for Celometer and for Heat. However, we are leaving out object storage simply because it's not really useful to also add Swift object storage onto these three nodes that we have. Those are basically just the limitations that we have in the setting here for this tutorial. By the way, Swift itself is not the only service that provides OpenStack object storage. There's other services as well. Most notably, Ceph through Rados Gateway has a means of interacting with a Ceph store as if it were a Swift store. And likewise, GlusterFS has what it calls rather endearingly UFO, Unified File and Object Storage, which allows me to interact with a GlusterFS file system as if it were a set of Swift containers. For those of you who are familiar with Amazon S3, that will sound relatively familiar, a RESTful object storage not unlike Amazon S3. So what S3 is to AWS, Swift is more or less to OpenStack. Okay, let's see how Alice is doing. Okay, so that is a handful of services there already. We should have that done in a moment. As you can see, we are doing the Cinder, that is the OpenStack block storage service at this time, and then also Heat. And we're going to give this a few more moments, and then we should be done with the API installation. Of course, you know, this is somewhat slower than it would be on an actual production box on real hardware, because what I'm doing here is I'm running three virtual machines on one laptop drive, which is inevitably going to be I/O bound. And that is something that you're probably going to be seeing on your boxes as well, specifically if you're using spinners. So if your laptop does not come with an SSD, then that may be really, really slow for you. So maybe a good thing to actually do this on real hardware for you. Okay. So was that it? Nope. In the meantime, we can move along for our next few steps. So right now, this node named Alice is just our API node, our infrastructure node, and our authentication node. And now we're going to add a little more to that. We're going to make it the controller node, storage node, dashboard node. And we're going to leave out metering and orchestration for right now because that's just going to take up too much time. Controller, we already have that. Controller, no, dashboard. Okay, that part is fine. What is that?
All the classes, I just wanted
to... Yes, for right now, there are 6 classes in all. We already had API, infrastructure, and auth. Okay. And we just added storage and dashboard. And then we can also go ahead and make Bob our compute node. We're going to run Puppet later on that. And we're going to make Charlie our network node here. So, okay, while this is running, of those who are in here who have deployed OpenStack in testing or production in some shape or form, for whom of you was that in the OpenStack Folsom release? For whom was it in Grizzly? And anyone actually using something earlier than that? Nope. Has anyone looked at Havana yet? No? Come on. Just out of curiosity, is anyone still downloading from the VM images from my box here? I hope not, right? And there's our NovaDB sync. That should be the last bit. Of those of you who are following along, has anyone hit any snags up to this point? Alex? Nope. Come on.
Have you, you will run the Puppet agent on Bob and Charlie later?
Yes.
Okay. After the response.
Yes. Exactly.
Either my notebook is much more faster than yours or something that I've missed because mine is finished.
Did it actually do something for you, or did it just...
I wrote a lot of Puppet stuff, but
okay.
It is strange that it was so much faster, so I probably missed something.
Not necessarily. Hang on 1 second. There we go. About time. Okay, and now I'm going to do something here. We're going to SCP over our, oops, SCP OpenStack RC to Bob. So we can actually work on Bob here. So doing the next Puppet Agent run, so we can actually install our controller services here. And in the interim, we can actually start interacting with our OpenStack here. So, there we go. You know what we're going to do? We're going to do this. And we should be able to do a Nova list at this time. There we go. It doesn't actually do anything at this point. It does do something, which is it actually talks to the OpenStack API services, but returns an empty list here. The same thing is true for Neutron netlist. There we go. And a few others as well. So here, that is the dashboard. And I hope that's the last time that's going to take quite as long. Because once that is done, we actually have an OpenStack dashboard to work with. And we should be able to actually start working with our OpenStack cloud about 45 minutes into the tutorial. That is a reasonably complex Apache configuration, which you really shouldn't need to worry about. And again, it's basically the Puppet modules do all this work for you. Sure. Here we go. So if you want to set up your nodes like I have here, I have the node named Alice. That is our API node, infrastructure node, API node, and authentication node, and also our storage, controller, and dashboard node. Our node named Bob is a compute node. And finally, Charlie is our network node. Sorry about that. That is a problem in my configuration, but not in yours. You are not going to see this issue because I actually don't have an SDB device here that I can use for my cinder volumes. Oop. Come on. And let's do that again. Because the only thing that's going to do is it's just going to create the volume group in the right place. And that's that. There's our cinder. There we go. Okay. All right. And now we finally have an OpenStack cloud that we can actually interact with. So we've got all of these services here. And most importantly, we also have, that's my OpenStack RC. I'm just going to take this password here that has been generated for me. And now let's see if we have an OpenStack dashboard. There we go. There is an OpenStack dashboard installed from scratch. You're going to have your own password that was generated for you, and you can log in here with a username of admin with that password. There we go. Whoops. What the heck? My web browser doesn't support cookies. There we go. Okay. This is what the OpenStack dashboard looks like. By this time, we actually already have a fully functional OpenStack cloud, except that it doesn't have any compute nodes yet, and except that it doesn't have outside network connectivity. But we're going to fix that in a moment. But what you can see here is that all of the services that we have defined are already available. And they're running. There they are. Those are all the API services. And we can interact with all of those. And we can interact with our specific tenant as well. So one thing that I'm able to do at this point, for example, is I can upload an image. There we go. And the image type that we're going to be using is an image is a distribution called Cirrus. It's a super tiny micro distribution, but it runs really well in cloud workloads. So what I can do here is I can create this image, and I am going to upload it from an image file. Come on. There we go. And I want, where's my Cirrus? There's my Cirrus. There we go. And that is going to be in the qcow2 format. And I'm just going to name it Cirrus. Oops. As you can see, OpenStack supports a number of image types, such as AMIs as well, or you can upload an ISO that you can then boot from. And it supports any disk format that qcow supports, such as the qcow2 format, just a raw disk, VDI, which comes out of VirtualBox, VHD, which comes out of Hyper-V, and VMDK, which comes out of VMware.
How do you connect to the dashboard?
The dashboard runs on Alice. That's the dashboard node. And you can connect to it on that specific node. That's 192.168.122.111, just on port 80. If you are currently unable to connect to that, that may be due to your VirtualBox network configuration, and I can show you afterward how you can do that. Okay. Likewise, what you can also do if you're familiar with VirtualBox is on your node named Alice, you can create port forwarding for port 80, forward that to any local port on your machine, and you should be able to access the dashboard that way. Okay, so Alice didn't do anything here. So Bob is currently busy installing or becoming a compute node. That's fine. So we have uploaded an image. Another thing that I typically want to do with my OpenStack tenant is I want to be able to ensure that I can log into machines that I create, preferably using SSH. So what I can do here is I can just use my SSH key, SSH add dash L. So that's my key, my public key part here. And I want to upload that under access and security. And that is how I store my new key pair here under the key pairs tab. I can import an existing key pair like this. I'm going to name that Florian.
I think you want to skip the first line.
Yeah.
SSH add line.
What was that?
On top of the public key.
Ah, thank you. Good point.
No, yeah.
There we go. There's my key pair. And another thing that I also do whenever I do this demo setup is I create a flavor. Flavors are, as you can see here, they're various virtual machine types that we can create. Tiny, small, medium, large, and X-large are what we can typically create. Here, when I'm demoing this on my laptop, I usually like to add another flavor, which I call M1 Nano, which is one CPU and just 256 mega RAM and all of that's going to be zero, and then I can create that, and that's more than sufficient for the Cirrus that I'm going to deploy here. Yes. Yes. Flavors come from Nova because you can manipulate them with a Nova flavor list. But so you have to set flavors globally for the entire cloud, and then you can make them available per tenant. It is not something you can create on a per tenant level.
Okay.
So you also need admin scope privileges, meaning you're able to manipulate more than one tenant. Okay. That is still Novaifying here. And because even though we don't have a network node at this point, we can already interact with the networking service. And there is more than one way to do that, as with anything in OpenStack. So for example, we could now go ahead and create networks here or create routers here, etc. But for the time being, we don't have anything. No networks, no routers, no connected instances to display. Now, anything that you can manipulate in OpenStack, you can manipulate either through the OpenStack web GUI, the OpenStack dashboard, Horizon, which is what we're doing here, or you can manipulate it through the JSON APIs directly, or you can be using one of the OpenStack CLIs, which are perfectly scriptable. So that is something that we're going to be doing here. So here on Alice, there's a little script here. I need to source that, obviously. And there's a little script here that's called create neutron networks. And if we run that, then even though we currently don't have any network nodes that are implementing these networks, that doesn't matter. We can still create them because we're only interacting with the neutron API. And that, in turn, is talking to a relational database. So it's now creating a port, a network, and a gateway for that network. And lo and behold, there's our network topology that has just changed. So what we have created is one virtual network. That's the one that you see in orange here that we call AdminNet. That's the one that is only going to be implemented within GRE tunnels, actually, in the OpenStack network. And then we have a virtual router, which we call provider router, and that then connects to an external network, which is actually a physical network. There we go. Come on. Hello. What was that? And that is, there we go. That's just about to run that. Oops. What was that? And that's going to be our final puppet run for this tutorial. And once that is done, we will be able to actually instantiate a guest. Okay, so that's Nova, and that's our compute node, and we're almost done. The only thing that we're still waiting for is for our network node to not only create the network services, but to also launch an L3 routing agent, a DHCP agent, and also a metadata proxy agent, so we can make sure that our boxes, in fact, can access the Nova metadata API service. And this is going to be the machine that we are going to create and connect to in a moment. And I'm going to prepare everything here for the actual launch of this instance. So we're going to create a virtual machine in our availability zone that we call Nova. We're going to name it Cirrus. We are going to boot this from an image, namely the image that we previously uploaded. I subsequently want to be able to connect to this machine using my SSH key pair. And I'm going to attach it to the admin network. And then we should essentially be good to go. There's our neutron, neutron agents. There's all that. By the way, in the process, things like service passwords, etc., are all generated for you. Just in case you're wondering what those OVS entries were, this actually builds what OpenStack does for you, or what OpenStack Neutron does for you, is it builds Open vSwitch GRE tunnels for you. And in this case, you can already see the scaffolding from the compute node. Which is that we have a tunnel bridge and we have an integration bridge, and they are tunneled to, or they are patched into one another here. But what you're not seeing as yet is the tunnels themselves, the GRE tunnels themselves, which are going to be brought up by the Neutron services as soon as they start. There's the Open vSwitch package. There's the other side of the integration bridge. Here's the tunnel bridge. And there we go. So let's see. Oh. And if by magic, we now have a configured GRE tunnel, so these boxes can now provide tenant networks that are being placed into GRE tunnels and are then relayed over to the network node. We shall see the other side of that here. So all of that is taken care of for you by Neutron, by the way. This has nothing to do with there's no puppet magic here. All of that is by the API service itself. And what you can also see is a few IP network namespaces, which these are using heavily for routing and DHCP. So now, moment of truth, let's launch this virtual machine. So that instance is currently spawning. So that means what happened in the background here is Nova API talked to the Nova scheduler. The Nova scheduler service is responsible for selecting a compute node that is suitable for launching this virtual machine based on a variety of parameters that we can configure. In this case, it's easy because we have only one virtual machine, one compute node that is capable of hosting this virtual machine. What also happens is respective image, namely the Cirrus space image that we have here, is being transmitted over to the compute node, and IP addresses are being allocated from Neutron for this new instance. It has received the IP address 10.5.5.3. And if we take a look here, we should be able to see a startup log from this virtual machine. What it has done here, it has received IP addresses from the Neutron DHCP service. That is what you can see down here. It obtains a lease for 10.5.5.3. It adds a DNS server as required, and then it connects to a magic URL, which is the Nova API, the Nova metadata API service, where it actually fetches its own metadata, such as, for example, the SSH key that we have created for it. And that is a complete boot of Cirrus here. We also should see a full log here if we selected that here. And so now let's take a look. Here's Charlie, and here is our Cirrus node. So let's see. And we're out to host. Oh, of course, yes, because what I also want to do is, for this instance, I would also want to allocate a floating IP address. That is, if you're familiar with AWS, that's what elastic IPs are in AWS, or floating IPs in OpenStack. In the external network, we have a floating IP address pool from which we can now allocate an IP address and associate that with that machine. So that has now been associated, and in a few seconds, there we go. There's our connection to that box, and here is our Cirrus machine. So in 63 minutes from zero, that is to say from complete bare Ubuntu 12.04, no OpenStack, no trace of OpenStack on it, a bit of Puppet, even on a slow box, a really slow box, at least IO-wise, within 63 minutes, we're getting to a completely working OpenStack cloud that can actually fire up a virtual machine. And not only can fire up a virtual machine, but just for completeness sake, we can also create a volume here. So, whoops, let's take a look here. So here's our proc partitions. That only has a VDA device, of course, so it's a single device that we booted from. I want to create a volume that I named test. I want to give it 1 gig in size. I want to make it empty, no source. I could also create a volume from an existing image. Here is the volume that I have created. In case, just in case you're curious, the way this is implemented in this case is something that we can see on our node named Alice. If we take a look at TGT Atom mode target op show, that is the volume that has just been created for us and exported as an iSCSI target completely automagically. And we should also, in fact, see that here. Oh, we don't have an LSSCSI here. Oops. Let's do this. So there's nothing here as yet. And if we now go ahead and attach, we want to attach that to the Cirrus instance as devvdb. So that has been attached. Let's take a look. We can see that on our node named Bob here, it has just attached in the background to iSCSI. And the machine itself doesn't even care. Whoops, it doesn't even care whether it's iSCSI or something completely different, because as far as it sees, it's just another virtual device that has been added to it. We're out of time, so unfortunately, I don't have the opportunity to go into metering and orchestration. However, if you would like to reproduce this tutorial, you may do so at any time. The only things that you need to do is you need to add the metering and orchestration node classes to presumably your node named Alice, and then you will be able to interact with a heat stack or Celometer statistics as well. I apologize for going slightly over time, and I apologize for the IO issues here. I hope this was interesting for you nonetheless. What this tutorial was meant to show you is that in a very short amount of time, and trust me, if you're doing this in real hardware, you can do it in 20 minutes or less, you can build an OpenStack Havana cloud, a fully fledged and fully workable and working OpenStack cloud that you can then use to deploy your virtual instances. So within 60 minutes on this machine or 20 minutes on an actual piece or set of hardware, you can go from building the cloud to actually using the cloud, and that's ultimately what you want to do. You don't want to be held up with building your cloud for too long. A few final words. If you like this talk, it would be great if you could let us know. Hastexo is our Twitter handle. If you want to refer back to these slides or use them for a presentation of your own, you're certainly welcome to do so. The sources are in the I'm sorry, there's actually an error there. It is LCEU 2013 in my personal GitHub repo. So that's github.com/fghaas/LCEU2013. And by the way, if you're interested in my slides from LinuxCon Europe last year, just substitute 2013 with 2012. And if you want to learn more about OpenStack, then I also encourage you to check out our schedule. It's the UK's schedule, sorry, which is on our website. We do have classes coming up in Munich later this year and also in Bangalore, and we have more in Sao Paulo in January. So if you're interested in that, please do take a look. Thank you very much for your kind attention. If you have any further questions, I'll be happy to stick around. If you do not, please enjoy your lunch and enjoy your afternoon. Have a great rest of the conference. Thank you.